All right, y'all, we about to get started. Sisters, cover your heads. Brothers, uncover your heads. Turn off all cell phones. We're going to stand and face Jerusalem and open up.
Make a joyful noise unto the Lord.
Make a joyful noise unto the Lord.
All ye lands.
All ye lands.
Serve the Lord with gladness.
Serve the Lord with gladness.
Come before his presence with singing.
Come before his presence with singing.
Know ye that the Lord, he is God.
Know ye that the Lord, he is God.
It is he that hath made us.
It is he that made us.
And not we ourselves.
And not we ourselves.
We are his people.
We are his people.
And the sheep of his pasture.
And the sheep of his pasture.
Enter into his gates with thanksgiving.
Enter into his gates with thanksgiving.
And into his courts with praise.
And into his courts with praise.
Be thankful unto him.
Be thankful unto him.
And bless his name.
And bless his name.
For the Lord is good.
For the Lord is good.
His mercy is everlasting.
His mercy is everlasting.
And his truth endureth to all generations.
And his truth endureth to all generations.
I've just read to you Psalms 100. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading of his word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
And we'll have a selection from the choir.
Let's show them how it's done.
Yes, sir.
Sabbath, everybody.
All right now.
I would like to thank the choir for a fine selection. All right, so we just came up from upstairs. All y'all that want to do the peeping and all that good stuff, y'all want to smell how the food smells. So I'm going to get y'all through this. But we just observed yesterday the Lord's Passover, well, virtually yesterday because it kicked in at sundown on Monday. But we observed it over the evening, which is when we're supposed to have that kick in. Yesterday night is when unleavened bread, the first day of it, kicked in, which is the 15th day of Abib. Now, what we want to go through is just like, because a lot of people that's here, they think they just eat some food and that's what it's all about. We're going to go into what actual unleavened bread actually means spiritually, as well as leaven, because what we're supposed to do is take all the leaven out of our houses. So what were we supposed to do? We're supposed to get rid of all the leavened bread. Not the Colgate and all the soaps and all that stuff like that. We're going to go through that in the text as well, because we got a lot of people that got rid of socks and deodorant and all that good stuff, because, oh, we got yeast in it, leaven in it, all that good stuff. We're going to go with the text and see what the Israelites actually did in Exodus, the 12th chapter, as well as see what it points to in the future, as well as what we're not supposed to have on us, because these are very important 7 days, and I'm going to show you exactly why. So we're going to start this lesson out in Leviticus, the 23rd chapter. Leviticus 23. And we're going to pick it up at verse 1. Leviticus 23 and verse 1. When you get there, read that, bro.
And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying.
Who is speaking to Moses? Right, so it's not Moses' law that we're about to read right here. Go ahead.
Speak unto the children of Israel and say unto them, concerning the feast of the Lord, which ye shall proclaim to be holy convocations, even these are my feasts.
So y'all can on your own time. Read verse 3 and 4. Let's talk about the Sabbath. That's one of his feasts. But we're going to deal with the main one that we're talking about today. Let's skip down to verse 5 and read.
In the 14th day of the first month at even is the Lord's Passover.
So that was what was yesterday virtually, right? That was the Passover that we all took at the evening on the 14th day of Abib. Go ahead.
And on the 15th day of the same month is the Feast of Unleavened Bread unto the Lord.
Uh-huh.
7 days ye must eat unleavened bread.
You see that? So the seven days we're supposed to eat unleavened bread, and that's on the 15th day of the first month. What is the first month? Abib. That's when we came out of Egypt. Go ahead and read.
And the first day ye shall have in a holy convocation.
So what is a holy convocation? It's a gathering. Holy gathering, right? Go ahead.
You shall do no servile work therein.
So we were supposed to have this day off, right? No servile work is buying and selling. A lot of people ask, like, can I do my play? Absolutely. Because we about to feast. We're going to read in the text what we can actually do according to it, but we can't do any servile work, which is buying and selling. Go ahead and read.
But ye shall offer an offering made by fire unto the Lord 7 days.
Uh-huh.
And the seventh day is a holy convocation. Ye shall do no servile work therein.
So what days we can't do no servile work? The first day of unleavened bread and the seventh day. Y'all hear me? So second day, I don't want to hear, hey, Jarrell, can I buy and sell? What did the text say? First and seventh, okay? No more Bible Q&A on this one. Now let's go to Exodus, the 12th chapter. We missed one, but I got all the text messages. So I'm glad we cleared that up. Exodus, the 12th chapter, and we're going to pick it up at verse 29. So this is going to be when the children of Israel actually did the Passover. This is when that angel came in and passed over all the firstborn of Israel that had the blood upon their doorposts, right? That's what we just covered when Brother Antonio got up here and taught. Now we're going to deal with the unleavened bread part of it because it points to something. Exodus, the 12th chapter, and pick it up at verse 29. Read that.
And it came to pass that at midnight the Lord smote all the firstborn in the land of Egypt.
Uh-huh.
From the firstborn of Pharaoh that sat on his throne unto the firstborn of the captive that was in the dungeon.
Read.
And all the firstborn of cattle.
Uh-huh.
And Pharaoh rose up in the night, he and all his servants and all the Egyptians.
Uh-huh.
And there was a great cry in Egypt, for there was not a house where there was not one dead.
So the Lord was not playing around. He said he was going to kill all the firstborn that don't have this blood upon their doorposts. And guess what? He followed through. I'm talking about down to the cattle. And they thought Pharaoh's son was going to get out of that. No, he didn't. Go ahead and read.
And he called for Moses and Aaron by night and said, rise up and get you forth from among my people.
Read the prior chapters. Pharaoh was not playing around when he said, no, I ain't going to let them go. Then he said he was going to let us go. We just can't take our cattle with us. So he was playing games. And now he said, rise up. Get you forth from among my people. What else? Go ahead and read.
Both ye and the children of Israel.
Uh-huh.
And go, serve the Lord as ye have said.
And what else? Go ahead.
Also, take your flocks and your herds.
You know it hurt. All the stuff that he said that the Israelites couldn't take with them. Nah, take it now. Get out of here. Go ahead and read. Mm-hmm.
As ye have said, and be gone, and bless me also.
Man, what happened to Tutankhamun and all these Egyptian gods? He said, bless me by the name of your God. Go ahead and read.
And the Egyptians were urging upon the people that they might send them out of the land in haste.
Uh-huh.
For they said, we be all dead men.
Ain't that something? So they pushing the Israelites out of there. Now, when we dealt with when we were kings, the Israelites took advantage of that. They spoiled them, right? But we ain't going to read that. Keep reading verse 34. Go ahead and read.
And the people took their dough before it was leavened.
Uh-huh.
Their kneading troughs being bound up in their clothes upon their shoulders.
You see that? So they had the dough, but they didn't have time for it to rise because they couldn't cook it. Didn't have time to rise. Skip down to verse 38 and read.
And a mixed multitude went up also with them, and flocks and herds, even very much cattle.
Uh-huh.
And they baked unleavened baked unleavened cakes of the dough which they brought forth out of Egypt.
Uh-huh.
For it was not leavened.
Uh-huh.
Because they were thrust out of Egypt.
Uh-huh.
And could not tarry.
Uh-huh.
Neither had they prepared them for themselves in any victual.
Ain't that something? So you got somebody like, we got a sister Betty, she baking cakes and everything. She's like, okay, yeah, just give me a little bit. I need at least a half an hour. The Israelites didn't even get that. That's why it couldn't rise. Go ahead and read.
Now the sojourning of the children of Israel who dwelt in Egypt were 430 years.
Read.
And it came to pass at the end of the 430 years, even the selfsame day it came to pass, that all the hosts of the Lord went out from the land of Egypt.
Uh-huh.
It is a night to be much observed unto the Lord for bringing them out from the land of Egypt.
Uh-huh.
This is that night of the Lord to be observed of all the children of Israel in their generation.
Ain't that something? So what does all mean? That means all.
All.
So you're talking about all the generations. This is just how we're supposed to teach the commandment to our sons and our sons' sons, our neighbor, and the whole nine. The mixed multitude was amongst us. Everybody should know about this and observe this, right? Now, let's go to Numbers, the 33rd chapter. Because y'all think the Lord just trying to punish you by eating the unleavened cakes. I know some people, my reader right here, that would much rather eat the matzah than he would regular bread. Eating it like some potato chips. I'm like, oh my goodness. Save some. You only got one box. Numbers 33. And we go pick it up. For the family, by the way. Numbers 33 and pick it up in verse 1.
These are the journeys of the children of Israel, which went forth out of the land of Egypt with their armies under the hand of Moses and Aaron.
Read.
And Moses wrote their goings out according to their journeys by the commandment of the Lord. And these are their journeys according to their goings out. And they departed from Ramses in the first month. On the 15th day of the first month, on the morrow after the Passover, the children of Israel went out with a high hand in the sight of all the Egyptians.
You see how important that is? This particular day, which is the 15th day of Abib, this is the same day that they came out in their armies out of Egypt. You understand me? Because in the Passover, they couldn't even leave because that thing was, the angel was coming around killing everything. Right after that, they left out of there and they spoiled the Egyptians on this particular day. That's how important it is. Now let's go back to Exodus, the 12th chapter. If we didn't read it already, I don't think we did. Nope, we didn't. Yep, Exodus 12, and pick it up at verse 15. Read that.
7 days shall ye eat unleavened bread.
How clear is that? 7 days we got to eat unleavened bread. Go ahead and read.
Even the first day, you should put away leaven out of your house.
So all that leaven is supposed to be out that crib, but watch how he breaks it down. Go ahead and read.
For whosoever eateth leavened bread from the first day until the seventh day, that soul should be cut off from Israel.
So I ain't tripping on y'all getting rid of your Colgate and your soaps and all that good stuff. But he said anybody that gets caught eating leavened bread is the ones that's going to get cut off from the children of Israel. You hear me? Go ahead and read.
And in the first day, there should be an holy convocation. And in the seventh day, there should be an holy convocation to you. No man or work should be done in them. Save that which every man must eat, that only may be done of you. And you should observe the Feast of Unleavened Bread. For in this selfsame day have I brought your armies out of the land of Egypt.
How many times we read that? We just read that twice, right? And that's the same, this the same day when he brought us out of the land of Egypt. Go ahead and read.
Therefore shall ye observe this day in your generations by an ordinance forever.
How long is forever?
Forever.
Okay, I think we should continue doing this. I don't know. Go ahead and read.
In the first month, on the 14th day of the month at even, ye shall eat unleavened bread until the 1 and 20th day of the month at even.
Ain't that something? So he say, in the first month, on the 14th day of the month at even. What was that 14th day? Passover, right? And he said, until the 21st day, you're supposed to eat unleavened bread. That is why when we took the Passover, we had the unleavened bread and the wine. We're taking the Passover being under the blood of Christ. Then we're going to continue doing that for 7 days. That seventh day after, that's when we don't have to eat anymore, but I know some people continue doing it. I ain't going to call no names. But go ahead and read. Did we finish that?
Yep. I mean, no, wait, 12, 15?
I believe it was 19. 19, read that.
Keep reading, okay. 7 days shall there be no leaven found in your house. For whosoever eateth that which is leaven, even that soul should be cut off from the congregation of Israel, whether he be a stranger or born in the land.
So this is harder than atonement for me because I love cookies and burgers and Philly cheese steaks and all that stuff. That is leaven. Right? That is risen bread. Okay? Yes. I'm over here like, oh man, I got everything out of there. I see these Chips Ahoy just sitting right up there. I'm like, what am I doing? Let me get this out of there too. I wish I had more time to eat it, you know. Go ahead and read. Verse 20.
You should eat nothing leavened, and all your habitations should you eat unleavened bread.
Ain't that something? So all of our habitations, wherever we dwell, we're supposed to eat this unleavened bread from the 14th to the 21st. That's understood? Now let's go to Numbers 28. Just nail this in the coffin. And the reason why I'm doing this is because it's a lot of people that are Israelites, by the way. They're saying that we can't keep the feast nowadays because we don't have the natural unleavened bread that the priests had. And when you go to Numbers 28, as well as Numbers 21, you'll see that they had unleavened cakes that they put a part of the freewill offering for the Most High. When they did these offerings, they didn't always have normal bread. They had unleavened cakes because they're doing it in remembrance of this. Numbers 28, and pick it up at verse 11. Y'all better know I sliced and diced them on it too. But yeah, Numbers 28 and 11, read that.
In the beginnings of your months, ye shall offer a burnt offering unto the Lord. 2 young bullocks and 1 ram, 7 lambs of the first year without spot.
Uh-huh.
And 3 tenths.
Oh, I'm sorry. Skip down to verse 16 and read that.
And in the 14th day of the first month is the Passover of the Lord.
Uh-huh.
And in the 15th day of this month is the feast.
Uh-huh.
7 days shall unleavened bread be eaten.
What feast is that? The feast of unleavened bread. Go ahead and read.
And the first day shall be an holy convocation.
Which is what we're doing today. Go ahead.
You shall do no manner of servile work therein.
Ain't that something? So we're reading the same thing throughout the law. Skip down to verse 25 and read.
And on the seventh day, you shall have an holy convocation. You shall do no servile work.
So is the book agreeing all the way throughout? We just read the same thing 4 or 5 times. Now let's go into the New Testament, and I'm going to show y'all what Christ was talking about with this leaven. 1 Timothy, the 5th chapter, and we're going to pick it up at verse 20. Because look through the Gospels, look through the times of Acts when Paul and Jesus were dealing with these Pharisees, these scribes, these ones that were putting themselves above the law, so to say, and so-called was the teachers of the law. Jesus is going to be dealing with them, but we're going to see what this leaven is all about. 1 Timothy 5, and pick it up at verse 20. Read that, bro.
Them that sin, rebuke before all, that others also may fear.
I am about to just let you sin and be silent about it and let you just walk on your way. Guess what I have to do? If that man is picking up sticks on the Sabbath day, he needs to be stoned in front of everybody so all may fear. So guess what? You a false prophet in front of me? I'm about to embarrass you in front of everybody too. That's what he's talking about. Go ahead and read.
I charge thee before God and the Lord Jesus Christ and the elect angels, that thou observe these things without preferring one before another, doing nothing by partiality.
Ain't that something? He said, don't have no respect to persons when it comes down to this. Let's see how Jesus actually did it. Let's go to Luke, the 12th chapter. See what this leaven's all about. We're going to see how Jesus actually did it. Y'all should just read all of Matthew. He's just slicing and dicing in all of Matthew throughout. Luke 12, and pick it up at verse 1. When you get there, read.
In the meantime, when there were gathered together innumerable multitude of people, insomuch that they trode one upon another, he began to say unto his disciples, first of all.
Now, you know what trode upon each other means? That means that they were stacked upon each other to hear the word of Jesus. That's how it should be every Sabbath. People should be in here stacked on each other, double parked, triple parked. Handicapped, you ain't got no handicap sticker. That's what it should be, because that's what it was when he was teaching. But we're going to see what he said when they trod upon each other. Go ahead and read.
Beware ye of the leaven of the Pharisees, which is hypocrisy.
What is the leaven? Hypocrisy. And he said, beware of the leaven of the Pharisees, which is hypocrisy. Let's see what hypocrisy is in totality. Let's go to Matthew, the 16th chapter. And I already know it. Like, if you was listening to Jesus teaching and he said, yeah, beware of that leaven, y'all going to be looking at him like, what? What are you talking about? And that's exactly what they're going to do in Matthew 16. I'm going to show you. Matthew 16, and pick it up at verse 1. Read.
The Pharisees also with the Sadducees came and tempting, desiring him that he would show them a sign from heaven.
Ain't that something? So these preachers are supposed to be trying to get a sign from Jesus, right? Oh, yeah, can we see a sign? We just want to see if you the real deal. Go ahead and read.
He answered and said unto them, when it is evening, ye say, it will be fair weather, for the sky is red.
Uh-huh.
And in the morning, it will be foul weather today.
Uh-huh.
For the sky is red and lowering.
Uh-huh.
Oh, ye hypocrites.
What do you call them? Hypocrites. Go ahead.
Ye can discern the face of the sky,
uh-huh,
but can ye not discern the sign of the time?
So y'all some weather forecasters all day, huh? You can tell me what's going to happen later on in the day, but you can't tell me about the signs of the times. So why are you asking me a question where you don't know nothing about what's going on? Go ahead and read.
A wicked and adulterous generation seeketh after a sign,
uh-huh,
and there shall no sign be given unto it, but the sign of the prophet Jonas.
Uh-huh.
And he left them and departed.
So just imagine, he said, I ain't giving y'all no sign. It's going to be one sign, the sign of the prophet Jonas, and he walked off. Now watch what they do. Go ahead and read.
And when his disciples were come to the other side, they had forgotten to take bread.
Uh-huh.
Then Jesus said unto them, take heed and beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and of the Sadducees.
So watch what the disciples say in response, because they're going to be confused. Go ahead and read.
And they reasoned among themselves, saying, it is because we have taken no bread.
So they said, the leaven is, because we didn't take no bread. Sorry, Jesus. Like, no, that's not what he's talking about. Keep reading, bro.
Which when Jesus perceived, he said unto them, O ye of little faith, why reason ye among yourselves? Because ye have brought no bread.
Uh-huh.
Do ye not yet understand? Remember the 5 loaves of the 5,000 and how many baskets ye took up.
Read that text. When Jesus fed them with the 5,000, fed the 5,000 with 2 loaves, it was a boy's dinner or his lunch or something, right? And he's like, how many baskets y'all take up then? I ain't worried about y'all bringing no bread. I'm talking about the leaven of the Sadducees and the Pharisees. Go ahead and read.
Neither the 7 loaves of the 4,000 and how many baskets ye took up.
Uh-huh.
How is it that ye do not understand that I spake it not to you concerning bread, that ye should beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and of the Sadducees?
Now, watch how they understand it. Go ahead and read.
Then understood they how that he bade them not beware of the leaven of the bread, but of the doctrine of the Pharisees and of the Sadducees.
Of the what? The doctrine. This is the doctrine of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. That's what the issue is. Now, let's go into Mark the 11th chapter. So that's what he told them, beware of, is that doctrine of the Pharisees and the Sadducees, which is full of hypocrisy, because they put tradition over the law. And Jesus is going to snap on them, too. I said, if I made a cartoon and we didn't have to worry about doing graven images and nothing like that, this is the first thing I'm doing, literally, with Jesus just snapping on all of them. Mark 11, and pick it up at verse 27. Read.
And they come again to Jerusalem. And as he was walking in the temple, they there come to him the chief priests and the scribes and the elders.
So these are the big preachers. And Jesus is walking in the temple, and they're about to try and catch him and ask him a question. Go ahead and read.
And saying to him, by what authority doest thou these things? And who gave thee this authority to do these things?
Uh-huh.
And Jesus answered and said unto them, I will also ask of you one question,
uh-huh,
and answer me, and I will tell you by what authority I do these things.
So he said, look, no, let me ask you a question, since y'all got so many questions, and I'll tell you by what authority I do these things. Answer me when I ask this question. Go ahead and read.
The baptism of John, was it from heaven or of men?
Uh-huh.
Answer me.
He said, look, the baptism of John, was it from heaven or of men? Answer me. Watch what they say. Go ahead and read.
And they reasoned with themselves, saying, if we should say, from heaven, he will say, why then did ye not believe him?
Uh-huh.
But if we shall say, of men, they feared the people. For all men counted John that he was a prophet indeed.
Read.
And they answered and said unto Jesus, we cannot tell.
So that's what their answer was. He said, answer me. Oh, we cannot tell, because if we say this, he gonna say this. And if we say this, he gonna say this. Oh, no, we ain't got the answer. Watch how Jesus answered them. Go ahead and read.
And Jesus answered and saith unto them, neither do I tell you by what authority I do these things.
So you can't answer my question, I ain't answering your question. Period, point blank. Now he's dealing with scribes, Pharisees, and the elders, right? Now let's go to Matthew, the 22nd chapter. Matthew 22. This is how you deal with hypocrites. This is how you do it. Matthew 22. And pick it up at verse 23. Now, there's two different sects of these preachers that are over the congregation, so to say, or over the sanctuary. There was the Pharisees, and there was the Sadducees. The difference between them two is the Sadducees didn't believe in the resurrection. The Pharisees did. But the one thing they agreed on is that they hated Jesus. So they're going to try and go in waves. Mm-hmm. Oh, the Sadducees going to go first, and then the Pharisees going to come right after. Y'all going to see how this goes down. Matthew 22, and pick it up at verse 23. Read, bro.
The same day came to him the Sadducees, which say that there is no resurrection, and asked him.
So they coming up, and they going to ask him about the marriage and the resurrection and such, and Jesus going to cut him on that, but we're not going to read it. Skip down to verse 31 and read.
But as touching the resurrection of the dead, have ye not read that which was spoken unto you by God, saying,
uh-huh,
I am the God of Abraham, and a God of Isaac,
uh-huh,
and a God of Jacob.
Uh-huh.
God is not the God of the dead, but of the living.
Y'all know what he's saying right there? If I am the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and y'all don't believe in the resurrection, I don't know what to tell you, because I ain't the God of the dead. They gonna rise again at the last trump. And guess what? Y'all ain't. Y'all gonna rise to that lake of fire. Go ahead and read.
And when the multitude heard this, they were astonished at his doctrine.
I bet they were. Go ahead.
But when the Pharisees had heard that he had put the Sadducees to silence.
So he shut the Sadducees up. Now the Pharisees like, oh man, what we gonna do? Go ahead and read.
They were gathered together.
Uh-huh.
Then one of them, which was a lawyer, asked him a question, tempting him and saying, Master, which is the great commandment in the law?
Ain't that something? So they asking all these questions, trying to trip him up, right? Watch how Jesus responds. Skip down to verse 41. Because they're going to try and gather together and ask him another question. Because he kill him and say, look, you keep you love the Lord thy God with all thy heart and with all thy soul, and you love your neighbor as yourself. By these are all the law and the prophets, right? Mm-hmm. They didn't have a response until after they're going to say this. Watch this. Verse 41. Read that.
While the Pharisees were gathered together, Jesus asked them, saying, what think ye of Christ? Whose son is he?
Do y'all think they're going to have the answer to this question that's sufficient? No. Go ahead and read.
They say unto him, the son of David.
Watch how Jesus cut them. Read.
He said unto them, how then doth David in spirit call him Lord, saying, the Lord said unto my Lord, sit thou on my right hand until I make thine enemies thy footstool?
My dad is not going to call me Lord. And that's what he's saying. He's like, look, oh, wait. How did David call him Lord in spirit, which is Psalm 110? The Lord said unto my Lord, sit thou on my right hand until I make thine enemies thy footstool. So he's like, how did he call him Lord if he is his son? Go ahead and read.
If David then called him Lord, how is he his son?
Read.
And no man was able to answer him a word. Neither durst any man from that day forth ask him any more questions.
Now, this is Matthew 22. Nobody asked him no more questions, right? But Jesus is about to snap in Matthew 23, which is what we're about to read right now. Go over to Matthew 23 and pick it up at verse 1. And read.
Then spake Jesus to the multitude and to his disciples, saying, the scribes and the Pharisees sit in Moses' seat. All therefore whatsoever they bid you observe, that observe and do. But do not ye after their works, for they say and do not.
Ultimate hypocrite, right? He said, no, whatever they bid you, and do what they bid you, but don't do as they do, because they are hypocrites. Go ahead and read.
For they bind heavy burdens and grievous to be borne. And they lay them on men's shoulders. But they themselves will not move them with one of their fingers. But all their works they do for to be seen of men.
So they just want to be seen of men. They only doing it for the glory of this earth. They want to be, oh, they reward here. They want to get up and go on stage and give $1 million check. And, oh, you are such a great God-fearing man. That's for he got his reward.
Yeah.
Right? Go ahead and read.
They make broad their phylacteries.
Y'all know what a phylactery is? You see them Jews when they walk around with that big box on their forehead during a certain time, and they make them broader. They make them larger just to show, oh, I keep all the commandments. Watch what else they do. Go ahead and read.
And enlarge the borders of their garments.
It's not enough for them to have fringes on. They got to make them long where they blow in the wind. Like, dude, we see you got the fringes on, but you know, no, I got to do extra. I want you to see my fringes. So they make broad their phylacteries, and they enlarge the borders of their garments. Go ahead and read.
And love the uppermost rooms at feasts and the chief seats in the synagogues.
Now, I'm telling y'all, I did a funeral, and it was with Marlon. Marlon had the pulpit. I got the reader seat. Y'all know the same place that we go, right? And this pastor wanted to walk up there and sit in my seat. Marlon like, no. I don't know what you thought this was. Ain't no guest pastor for none of this. All y'all, and I was like, Ebenezer Baptist Church, all y'all stay over there. That pastor, well, he wanted to sit up there. He did. He like, no, y'all know how it is at church. Y'all know how it is. Guest pastor come, you're going to have a seat ready for him. Lemonade's going to be just for him, just like the regular pastor. Right? That ain't happening all the time in the book. Watch what else ain't happening. Go ahead and read. Verse 7.
And greeters in the markets, and to be called of men, rabbi, rabbi.
Ain't that something? You know what rabbi means? Master. Right, go ahead.
But be not ye called rabbi, for one is your master, even Christ, and all ye are brothers.
So my question was all the time, like, why y'all call him Brother Marlon? This is why. Yeah, I ain't calling Father Marlon, like a certain doctrine out here, Roman Catholic Church, right? Yes. Calling the little 17-year-old boy father. That's what they do, but the text say don't do that, right? Go ahead and read.
And call no man your father upon the earth.
Now, that's not saying that you can't call your actual birth father father. He's talking about spiritual father. Go ahead.
For one is your father, which is in heaven.
Uh-huh.
Neither be ye called masters, for one is your master, even Christ.
I think some people need to read that, right? Now skip down to verse 13 and read. Because he's given a full out breakdown to them on what you are supposed to do and what you're not supposed to do. Guess what? If the glove is fitting these Pharisees and the Sadducees and the scribes and the elders, and he's speaking in the open and telling the disciples and the multitude that was piled up on top of each other to hear his word, that's who he's talking to. Go ahead and read. Verse 13.
But woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites.
Now he turned around to these Pharisees and these scribes. Said, woe unto you, which is a warning, right? Scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites. What is a hypocrite? Somebody that say and they do not. Somebody that say, oh, well, you can't steal. And their whole job is stealing. Or they just do it in a different way, right? So they'll steal your phone and try and help you find it. And then when they find it, they say, oh, yeah, this guy said it was a reward for $50. That's extortion. But then they'll say, oh, thou shalt not steal. But then they out here doing the most stealing. That's a hypocrite. Go ahead and read.
For ye shut up the kingdom of heaven against men.
Uh-huh.
For ye neither go in yourselves, neither suffer ye them that are entering to go in.
Ain't that something? So they going around and they getting people to become a part of their doctrine. They not going in the kingdom. And now that person ain't going in the kingdom. That's why Jesus got an issue with them. Go ahead and read.
Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites.
That's the second time he called them hypocrites to their face.
Yeah.
Now, I ain't telling y'all just go back to your family and grandma's house and say, grandma, you a hypocrite. No, you can't. I ain't telling y'all do that. I'm just telling you how Jesus got down, okay? Go ahead and read.
For ye devour widows' house.
Uh-huh.
And for a pretense, make long prayer.
What's long prayer? That devotion. It's got to be heard. Just got to get love from a man, right? Go ahead and read.
Therefore, ye should receive the greater damnation.
Guess what? You want your long prayer to be heard? Guess what? You're going to get a greater damnation. Hold this here. Let's go to Proverbs 28. Show you that damnation. Please remember what verse we was at, because I definitely don't know.
Okay,
cool. Right on. As long as we got to understand it. Proverbs 28, and pick it up at verse 9. It's 9 of y'all sheets. Read that.
28:1.
And verse 9. Read that.
He that turneth away his ear from hearing the law, even his prayer should be an abomination.
I don't know what to tell you. You ain't keeping the law. I don't care how long your prayer is, it ain't going to work. Your prayer is going to be abomination in the eyes of the Most High. Now, let's go back to Matthew 23 and wherever we were. If I can't find where we was, we just going to start over. No, we know. But Matthew 23, and let's pick it up at verse 15, I believe.
Okay.
Read that.
Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites.
That's the third time he called them hypocrites. We ain't reading the whole thing. We skipping around. You just read this whole chapter and see how many times he called them hypocrites. But go ahead.
For ye compass sea and land to make one proselyte.
Y'all know what a proselyte is? It's a convert. Somebody that converted to the faith. So they're going across sea and land to make one convert. Go ahead.
And when he is made, ye make him twofold more the child of hell than yourself.
You should have kept him in the world. Now you made him worse because he came to your doctrine. And you can pass in sea and land to go make this one proselyte more the child of hell or twice the child of hell than yourselves. Go ahead and read. I'm sorry, skip down to verse 23 and read that.
Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites.
Uh-huh.
For ye pay tithe the mint and anise, and cumin, and have omitted the weightier matters of the law.
When you look at mint and anise and cumin, it's very expensive, right? And they're doing it. Oh, I gave my book. This is the greatest right here. And he gonna say you don't follow the weightier matters of the law. And what is it? Go ahead and read.
Judgment, mercy, and faith.
So you ain't got that, bro. I don't care what you give as your tithe. Go ahead and read.
Judgment, mercy, and faith.
Read.
These ought ye to have done, and not to leave the other undone.
What'd he call them?
Ye blind guides.
What'd he say? He called them blind guides. Go ahead.
Which strain at a gnat and swallow a camel.
Can you swallow a camel?
No.
Then it's for nothing. Your whole doctrine is vain, right? And you got some people that'll be like, I believe that I could teach that the earth is flat, which I don't even get in that argument. But, bro, what does that have to do with salvation? I'll have the argument with you. I can show you in the text that he said up on the circle of the earth, That's in the Bible. You can't see no flat nothing anywhere. So we'll have that conversation. But what that got to do with salvation, right? Nothing. Go ahead and read.
Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites.
Uh-huh.
For ye make clean the outside of the cup and of the platter.
Uh-huh.
But within they are full of extortion and excess.
Ain't that something? So we were taught that when somebody come up looking nice in a suit, they got some nice Stacey Adams on, a nice new belt, and a whole nine, that's a righteous man.
Yeah.
Right? You see the sisters that have the full-out white dress on and the white little scarf and all that good stuff. They righteous. Right? In the Israelite community, you got these brothers with the super-duper fringes on, ribbon of blue that's not even the actual blue. Oh, they're righteous. And any sister with a scarf, I don't care if they got a scarf on, that don't mean that they righteous. Okay? But they look good on the outside, but within are full of dead man's bones and excess. Right? Go ahead and read.
In the middle.
26.
Not my fault. Thou blind Pharisee.
Uh-huh.
Cleanse first that which is within the cup and platter, that the outside of them may be clean also.
So he said, clean the inside first. Go ahead and read.
Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites.
That's like time number six. He called them hypocrites. Damn. Go ahead and read.
For ye are like unto whitest sepulchres, which indeed appear beautiful outward, but they are full, but are within full of dead men's bones and of all uncleanness.
Ain't that something? Ain't that crazy? Go ahead and read.
Even so, ye also outwardly appear righteous unto men, but within ye are full of hypocrisy and iniquity.
Ain't that leaven? That's what it is, that hypocrisy, that's what the leaven is. During these 7 days, we're supposed to be trying to get all of that off of us. That is the sin and the hypocrisy. If you see anything that you're doing that could be a hypocrisy, get that off of you. That's what this feast is about. Go ahead and read.
Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites.
Number seven, go ahead.
Because ye build the tombs of the prophets and garnish the sepulchres of the righteous.
Ain't that something? They the ones that killed Jesus eventually too. Go ahead and read.
And say, if we had been in the days of our fathers, we would have not been partakers with them in the blood of the prophets.
Ain't that something? So they fathers and mothers are the ones that said, no, kill him because he's telling the truth. But no, if we was back then, we wouldn't have did that. And Jesus just like, yes, you would have because y'all doing it now. Go ahead and read.
Wherefore, be ye witnesses unto yourselves that ye are the children of them which killed the prophets.
So he's just going right at them. Go ahead and read.
Fill ye up then the measure of your father. Ye serpents, ye generation of vipers. How can ye accept the damnation of hell?
You see this? You see how Jesus is dealing with them? He said he called them vipers. He called them serpents. And he said, how can you escape the damnation of hell? Because he said, y'all are going to measure up to what y'all fathers did, which is killed the prophets. Y'all doing the same thing. And y'all doing it by not only your doctrine, but you also doing it physically as well. Y'all get out there. I'm telling you, man, when the time come, when we have to dwell and flee to the wilderness, and y'all stay over here, all right, y'all going to see how it go. Y'all going to see how it go when you start saying, oh, well, I'm circumcising my son on the eighth day. You're going to be proud about it on Facebook. Please, the people going to try and find you just like they did P. Diddy. So stop playing games. Now, let's go to Job 27. Y'all heard about the raid. They're going to be raiding y'all crib, too, if you stay here. Job 27. I said, whoa, this is funny, but then this is not funny because at the time of when we're supposed to flee, they're going to be coming after you just like that.
Yes.
Job 27, and pick it up at verse 1. I'm talking about they got both of his cribs. They got Miami and Los Angeles. That's a raid right there. Job 27. Let's see what Job had to say about hypocrisy. Job 27, and pick it up at verse 1. Read that.
Moreover, Job continued his parable and said, as God liveth, who hath taken away my judgment, and the Almighty, who hath vexed my soul. All the while my breath is in me, and the Spirit of God is in my nostrils. My lips shall not speak wickedness, nor my tongue utter deceit.
So y'all know what Job went through, right? That's why everybody would say, oh, you patient, just like Job. Because he went through a lot, right? Go ahead and read.
God forbid that I should justify you. Till I die, I will not remove my integrity from me.
And look, I'm going to tell you something. The people around Job tried to make him remove his integrity. Remember his wife said, why don't you just curse God and die? And he said, you speak as the foolish woman speaking. God gave me this, and I came in this earth naked. I can leave the same way. I will be all right, because he had a lot of substance. Go ahead and read.
My righteousness I hold fast, and I will not let it go.
Ain't that how we're supposed to be in mindset? Hold on to that righteousness. Hold fast to that righteousness, not wickedness. Go ahead and read.
My heart shall not reproach me so long as I live.
Go ahead.
Let my enemy be as the wicked, and he that riseth up against me as the unrighteous.
Now, he going to tell you what the wicked going to get. Go ahead and read.
For what is the hope of the hypocrite?
The hope of who? Of the hypocrite. What's the hope of them? What they asking for in the last day by being a hypocrite? Go ahead and read.
Though he hath gained, when God taketh away his soul.
Ain't that something? He told them, how you going to escape the damnation of hell? He said the end of the hypocrite is going to be that they soul going to be taken by God. Go ahead and read.
Will God hear his cry when trouble cometh upon him?
Ain't that something? We read that in Proverbs 28. The prayer of a sinner is abomination to the Most High. Go ahead and read.
Will he delight himself in the Almighty?
Uh-huh.
Will he always call upon God?
Go ahead.
I will teach you by the hand of God.
Uh-huh.
That which is with the Almighty will I not conceal.
Read.
Behold, all ye yourselves have seen it.
Uh-huh.
Why then are ye thus altogether vain?
You say, you seen what God be doing. Why are y'all still vain? Go ahead and read.
This is the portion of a wicked man with God.
Uh-huh.
And the heritage of oppressors.
Uh-huh.
Which they shall receive of the Almighty.
Uh-oh. Y'all know what they're going to receive? That recompense. Y'all know what the recompense is. Y'all, look, we got an older crowd in here. Y'all love James Brown. The big payback. That's what the recompense is. Okay? Go ahead and read. Yeah.
If his children be multiplied, it is for the sword.
Uh-huh. So he said, if his children be multiplied, it is for the sword. What does that mean? They're multiplied just to die. Go ahead and read.
And his offspring shall not be satisfied with bread.
Ain't that something? Go ahead and read.
Those that remain of him should be buried in death.
Uh-huh.
And his widow shall not weep.
Uh-huh.
Though he heap up silver as the dust.
Uh-huh.
And prepare raiment as the clay.
Uh-huh.
He may prepare it, but the just shall put it on.
Uh-huh.
And the innocent shall divide the silver.
So you got all this money. You got all these clothes. You looking good. All the good stuff. Guess what? The righteous and the just are going to take your clothes, and they're going to divide your silver. Thanks for preparing it for us. Go ahead and read.
He builded his house as a moth and as a booth that the keeper make.
Uh-huh.
The rich man shall lie down,
uh-huh,
but he shall not be gathered.
Uh-huh.
He opened his eyes, and he is not.
Ain't that something? He can see, but he can't see. Go ahead and read.
Tears take hold on him as water.
Uh-huh.
A tempest stealeth him away in the night.
More money, more problems. That's why I'm like, don't give me too much. I'm cool. As long as I ain't in overdraft, and as long as I can take my wife on a date, that's all I need. I'm talking about on the spot, okay? Not going into my savings and all that good stuff, which my savings could be my brother's. Hey, let me hold $100 real quick. You know what I'm saying? And they send it immediately. I'll be like, okay, right on. Hey, man, you want to go out to? Terrible. Go ahead and read.
Terrors take. Oh, wait, I read that.
Yo, the 20. You good? 20 carry, is good.
Yeah, 20. Terrors take hold on him as waters. A tempest stealeth him away in the night.
Uh-huh.
The east wind carrieth him away.
Uh-huh.
And he departeth.
Uh-huh.
And as a storm hurleth him out of his place.
Read.
For God shall cast upon him,
uh-huh,
and not spare him.
Uh-huh.
He would fain flee out of his hand.
Uh-huh.
Men shall clap their hands at him,
uh-huh,
and shall hiss him out of his place.
Ain't that something? So they're going to be messing with this wicked hypocrite. And that's what Job is saying. Like, hey, you know what? Okay, so let's go to 1 Timothy. No, we already read 1 Timothy 5. Let's go to Titus, the first chapter. Titus 1. Yeah, we already read 1 Timothy 5. We got it in there twice. Titus 1 and verse 10. Titus is right after Timothy. 1 and 2 Timothy is right after. And I believe before Philemon. I didn't hear any murmurs about page numbers, but, you know, that was a little help for y'all. Titus 1, and pick it up at verse 10. Read.
For there are many unruly and vain talkers and deceivers, especially they of the circumcision.
Who is the circumcision?
Israel.
So that's the problem, isn't it? Think about all the false prophets you've seen in your life outside of Smiling Joy Osteen. No. Who is the main one that's in your face saying, God said this, God said that? It's Israel, right? Go ahead.
Whose mouths must be stopped.
They what? Their mouths must be stopped. Go ahead.
Who subvert whole houses,
uh-huh,
teaching things which they are not for filthy lucre's sake.
Y'all know what filthy lucre is, right? It's money, right? But money isn't the bad thing. It's the love of that money. And they'll do anything for it. That's the problem. Go ahead and read.
One of themselves, even a prophet of their own, said, the creatures are always liars,
uh-huh,
evil beasts, slow bellies.
Uh-huh.
This witness is true. Wherefore, rebuke them sharply, that they may be sound in the faith.
How are you supposed to rebuke them? That's what it say. We ain't supposed to argue the Bible. Oh, my goodness. Like, it'd be so funny. I'll be on Clubhouse, and, like, I'll be looking at myself, like, I am literally screaming at my phone. What is going on? But I'm like, nah, you going to hear this. Rebuke them sharply. Go ahead and read. 14.
Not giving heed to Jewish fables and commandments of men that turn from the truth.
Ain't that something? So we're not supposed to give heed to Jewish fables, commandments of men that turn from the truth. What is Easter? It's coming up right now. I'm talking about Eostre, straight up commandment of man. You better be at that church with your nice suit, white shoes, a whole nine. That was the commandment that you got from grandma, big mama.
Yeah.
And y'all had to do it. And if you didn't do it, they disown you. Guess what? The Lord gonna disown you if you don't keep that Feast of Unleavened Bread, huh? So which one you want? I'll take the Lord, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
go ahead and read.
Unto the pure, all things are pure. But unto them that are defiled and unbelieving, it's nothing pure. But even their mind and conscience is defiled.
So ain't nothing pure to them. Go ahead and read.
They profess that they know God.
How many times you see your family members professing that they know God more than you? Because they have a personal relationship with God. And you don't know my personal relationship with God. And what do they do all the time before their devotion? I would like to give honor and praise to Jesus Christ, which is the head of my life, in whom I have a personal relationship. And then they go right into it. That's a problem, ain't it? Go ahead and read.
But in works, they deny him.
See that? So if they got them works, I don't know. I don't care what you say. You keep the first day of the week, you ain't got them works. You denying the Lord, right? If you ain't keeping the feast, you denying him. Go ahead and read.
Being abominable and disobedient, and unto every good work, reprobate.
Y'all know what a reprobate is? There's no chance for them. No chance. They all the way at the end, and the Lord put a reprobate mind on them because they wanted it. Guess what? You got it. Now you ain't going to do nothing right. And they cool with that. Those are the ones that are okay with the homosexuals and abortion and those things like that. And they're like, yo, I like that. Keep on doing that. They're the ones that honor that. Yeah. Now let's go to Ezekiel, the 13th chapter. Oh, yeah, facts.
Yeah.
But you said your mic cut off. Yeah, they're going to get cut off, yes.
Yeah, they're going to get cut off, yeah.
Ezekiel 13, and pick it up at verse 1. I'm starting to smell the food, so I might skip some of these. I don't know what it is, man. I started to smell it just now. I don't know what that was. Ezekiel 13, and pick it up at 1. Read that.
And the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, Son of man, prophesy against the prophets of Israel that prophesy, and say thou unto them that prophesied out of their own hearts, hear ye the word of the Lord.
So y'all prophesying something that the Lord didn't say, so guess what? Now it's time for you to actually hear what the Lord said. So he said, Son of man, prophesy against the prophets of Israel that prophesy, and say thou unto them that prophesy out of their own hearts, not from the Lord, hear ye the word of the Lord. What's it going to say? Go ahead and read.
Thus saith the Lord God. Woe unto the foolish prophets that follow their own spirit and have seen nothing.
Man, how many times y'all deal with somebody like this? Or watch it at 3 o'clock in the morning. You just like, oh, how did I wake up? I can't go to sleep now. Because you got somebody just speaking out of their own mind. And God showed me that if you get this cloth, that you're going to have nothing. Bro, come on. And I know some of y'all fell for that. I'm glad you're here now. Verse 4, read.
O Israel. Thy prophets are like the foxes in the desert.
Now, you know what a fox will do. They'll do anything to eat, right? And they'll almost kill anything. And they're very sly and very smart. So a fox, like you got a pet dog or a cat at the house, guess what? That fox will jump that fence and kill your cat or your dog. That's how sly they are. But they don't do it just like, oh, I'm going to go try and do it this first day. They'll scout out and make sure that the dog does the same thing every time, so that he could sneak up on the dog and kill him. See what I'm saying? That's why whenever they seen a fox, they was like, nah, we got to kill that little bugger because he going to try and kill my stuff, kill my cows and my goats. And he will do it. Go ahead and read.
Ye have not gone up into the gaps.
Uh-huh.
Neither made up the hedge for the house of Israel to stand in the battle in the day of the Lord.
Read.
Ye have seen vanity and lying divination, saying, the Lord saith, and the Lord have not sent them.
Ain't that something the Lord said? I ain't say that. I ain't even seen you. Go ahead and read.
And they have made others a hope that they would confirm the word. Have you not seen a vain vision? And have ye not spoken the lying divination? Whereas ye say, the Lord saith it, albeit I have not spoken.
Ain't that something? And I had this guy, boy, I need to uninstall Clubhouse. But this dude was saying that he died and went to hell, and now he's back to tell us the story. So I'm just like, all right, so yeah, what was the story, bro? What's going on? I was like, because we read him the text where it wasn't created yet, right? And he just swore up and down that Satan had a pitchfork, and he seen Judas and a couple other people up in there. And he was saying, I recognize them by faith. It was ridiculous. Mm-hmm. And he was dead serious. But this is a divination and a dream that I don't know where he got that from. But people need some help. Therapy. Verse 8. Read.
Therefore, thus saith the Lord God, because ye have spoken vanity and seen lies, therefore, behold, I am against you, saith the Lord God.
Read.
And my name shall be upon the prophets that see vanity and that divine lies.
Uh-huh.
They shall not be in the assembly of my people.
Uh-oh, that's dangerous. Now you talk about salvation now, right? They're not going to be in the assembly of the Lord's people. Go ahead and read.
Neither should they be written in the writing of the house of Israel.
Y'all know what that writing is, right? Remember that book, and another book was opened, which they were judged according to their works? That's talking about the book of life that Moses was like, hey, blot me, I pray thee, out of thy book. Look, I ain't going to never ask for that for Jamel or anybody up in here.
Nope.
I don't know what, I'm barely making it. I'm like, no, I ain't about to ask. Look, Jamel got his own stuff, okay? I don't know what he do on his own time. I'll pray for him, but I ain't about to say, blot me out of the book. No, no, no. I barely got in there.
Nah.
Go ahead and read.
But we in the middle.
Middle of that. Neither. Go ahead.
Neither shall they enter into the land of Israel.
Uh-huh.
Ye shall know that I am the Lord God.
Read.
Because they have seduced my people.
So they seduced them. They did it by trickery. Go ahead and read.
Saying, peace. And there was no peace.
Uh-huh.
And one built up a wall, and lo, others daubed it with untempered mortar.
Now, what is untempered mortar going to do for you? So you literally ain't got, like, okay. I'm just going to, like, design this for y'all, okay? Y'all see that down there? If we started putting a brick upon a brick upon a brick with no mortar in between it, guess what? All Jamel got to do is kick that. And it's coming down. That's it. That's what they building, right? Go ahead and read.
Say unto them which daub it with untempered mortar, that it shall fall.
Uh-huh.
There should be an overflowing child.
Uh-huh.
And ye, oh, great hailstones shall fall.
Uh-huh.
And a stormy wind shall rend.
So the Lord ain't got to do too much to knock it over, but he said, look, we about to bring the thunderstorm. We about to bring some hail. We about to bring some wind. It's going to fall. Go ahead and read.
Lo, when the wall is fallen, shall it not be said unto you, where's the daubing wherewith ye have daubed?
Uh-huh.
Therefore, thus saith the Lord God, I will even rend it with a stormy wind in my fury.
Uh-huh.
And there should be an overflowing shower in mine anger.
Uh-huh.
And great hailstones of my fury to consume.
Ain't that something? Because y'all are building untempered mortar, which is talking about Israel not being taught correctly. But you got people in the land that's adding sin to sin, and you as a preacher saying, oh, don't worry about that. Peace. Peace in the land because we say it's peace. And the Lord like, it's about to be destruction because y'all sinning out here. And the preachers are preaching lies. That's what the issue is, but it's a reason why we want those lies. Let's go to Isaiah, the 30th chapter. See why we want those lies. And you, bro, you going to start at verse 1. Because we starting at verse 1 and we're going to skip to 8, okay? Verse 1, read that.
Woe to the rebellious children, saith the Lord.
Uh-huh.
That take counsel, but not of me.
Didn't we just read about that? You got some people that's taking counsel. He said, I ain't send these dudes. Go ahead and read.
And that cover with the covering, but not of my spirit, that they may add sin to sin.
What is sin? It's the transgression of the law, right? And they said, it's not only going to be one sin. We're going to add some more to it. Go ahead and read. Skip down to verse 8. Read that.
Now go, write it before them in the table, and note it in a book.
You just hit it. I'm going to tell y'all something, man. I don't know, like, particularly, like, where y'all hiding places was, but if you hide your money in a Bible, in the Old Testament, nobody going to find it. Period. Even if you put it in the Psalms and Proverbs, your money is safe. Safe in the safe. Right? So they hid. They said, no, now go, write it before them in the table and note it in the book. It's hidden from Israel. Go ahead and read.
That it may be for the time to come forever and ever.
That what? Go ahead and read.
That this is a rebellious people.
Uh-huh.
Lying children. Children that will not hear the law of the Lord.
Now watch what they say to the ones that's supposed to be teaching them the law. And they come in and say, hey, bro, y'all out of pocket. This is going to come at you if y'all ain't keeping this law. Watch how they respond to them. Read, bro.
Which say to the seers, see not.
Uh-huh.
And to the prophets, prophesy not unto us right things. Speak unto us smooth things. Prophesy deceits.
Ain't that something? This is why we going through what we going through. This untempered mortar is what is going on, and we got hypocrites out here saying, oh, yeah, you know, y'all can do it this way. And then meanwhile, when the Lord show up or the man of the Lord show up, oh, no, we've been telling them not to steal. But they haven't been doing that. Go ahead and read.
Get you out of the way. Turn aside out of the path. Cause the Holy One of Israel to cease from before
us. Ain't that something? So they said, put the Lord away from us. We don't want to hear that. And how many times you have a situation where you're trying to bring them the word when they ask you a question and they don't want to hear it all of a sudden? Oh, because it goes against your tradition and your doctrine. I'm sorry. Yeah. I don't know what to tell you. You one brought me to Genesis 2. Let's talk about it now. Oh, you don't want to talk? Oh, okay, cool. Yeah, let's move on. Because it's usually what happens. Let's go to 2 Timothy 3. How you going to start the conversation and now you want to have it no more?
You got to tell them.
Second Timothy 3, and let's pick it up at verse 1. 2 Timothy 3 and 1. Read.
This know also that in the last days perilous times shall come.
Go ahead.
For men should be lovers of their own selves.
Uh-oh.
Covetous.
That's a problem, ain't it? He said perilous times going to come, which is not good times. And he said for men should be lovers of their own selves. What else?
Covetous. Uh-huh. Boasters. Prouds. Blasphemers. Disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy.
Is any of that stuff biblical that they got as far as attributes? Absolutely not. They're disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy. They blasphemers, which means they blaspheme the name of God. I got a whole bunch of atheist friends and just be like, hey, man, and just like they told Elder Dominic, they said, F his God. That's blaspheming. That is ultimate. And the Lord going to be like, that book is open. Oh, what you say? Oh, yeah, yeah. Remember that? Left, left. Go to the left. Go ahead.
I said, wait, man, that's both. No,
verse three.
Sorry. Without well, natural.
I made you start at the top. Verse three.
I'm sorry. Without natural affection.
Wait, now they got no natural affection. What is natural affection? A man and a woman. The unnatural affection is, oh no, I want to try this man real quick and see how that goes. Or I'm going to try this dog. Or I'm going to try this horse. And that's what they're doing. Without natural affection, go ahead.
Oh, my goodness. Truce breakers.
Truce breakers, go ahead.
False accusers.
Uh-huh.
Incontinent.
Uh-huh.
Fierce.
Uh-huh.
Despisers of those that are good.
Ain't that something? They hate the people that do good. They despise them. Go ahead and read.
Traitors. Heady. High-minded. Lovers of pleasure more than lovers of God.
Ain't that something? That's the problem, ain't it? Right? And I had it like when I first came back in, and it would be people that would be like looking outside like, oh, when the Sabbath over, man? When is that sun going down? I'm like, okay, this is the time you're supposed to be studying. You know what I'm saying? Like, we'll be doing Bible trivia and have a little Bible question and answer and all that good stuff. And you got somebody that can't wait to get their Game Boy out. Like, I'm like, bro, relax. Relax. Go ahead and read.
Traitors, heady, high-minded, lovers of pleasure more than the lovers of God.
Uh-huh.
Having the form of godliness.
So they got that form of godliness, but what?
But denying the power thereof.
Uh-huh.
From such, turn away.
Uh-huh.
For of this sort are they which creep into houses
uh-huh.
and lead captive silly women laden with sin,
uh-huh.
led away with diverse lusts,
uh-huh.
ever learning, and never able to come to the knowledge of the truth.
Ain't that something? You just learning forever, the same nonsense, but you never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. That's the issue. And I mean, praise God that we don't have to deal with that, but then now we have to teach those people that are going through this. I'm telling you, like, look at the Sunday church, filled with women that have emotional issues and all that good stuff, and the pastor just delved right on them, on their issues and say, see, this is why you doing this, and this is why you're this, and I'm here to help you. But give me your check, though. You know, I need it gross, not net. And that's exactly what's happening. And these girls, they be going crazy over pouring his lemonade. Because they just like got these issues going on because Satan all over them. And guess what? Satan's pastor is their pastor. So that's the issue. Skip down to verse 13 and read.
But evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse,
uh-huh.
deceiving and being deceived.
So these evil men and seducers are deceiving and being deceived. They're going to be falling in deception. Now let's go to the next text. Let's go to Matthew the 7th chapter. I said we was going to start this at verse 1, but I am smelling the food, so I ain't going to do y'all like that as well as myself. Matthew 7, chapter. Because we talk about hypocrisy. I mean, Jesus go right into it in verse 1 through 5. I'm just not going to do y'all like that. Y'all can read that on your own. He's just talking about judging not, lest ye be judged. Whatever judgment ye judge, it shall be measured to you again. And whatever measure you meet, it shall be measured unto you. So he's basically saying, if you judge a person a certain way, guess what? You don't follow through, that same thing that you judge them on, you're going to be judged the same exact way. But yeah, Matthew 7, and pick it up at verse 13. Read that.
Enter ye in at the straight gate.
Uh-huh.
For wide is the gate, and broad is the way that leadeth to destruction.
Uh-huh.
And many there be which go in there.
So I don't want to be a part of the stadium. I like how small this is, right? I do want people piled up in this little church we got right here. But I don't want to be in the stadium where they like, oh, can we get the pews up there and get this? I don't want that. I'm cool on that. That's the broad. Go ahead and read. Right.
Because straight is the gate, and narrow is the way which leadeth unto life.
Uh-huh.
And fear there be the fine.
Uh-huh.
Beware of false prophets.
Beware of who? False prophets, go ahead.
Which come to you in sheep's clothes,
uh-huh,
but inwardly they are raven and wolves.
Now, how you know who they are? Go ahead and read.
You should know them by their fruits.
Uh-huh.
Do men gather grapes of thorns or figs of thistles?
Uh-huh.
Even so, every good tree bringeth forth good fruit, but a corrupt tree bringeth forth evil fruit.
Ain't that something? So he said, look, you can't have somebody that is evil with good fruit on their tree. So you'll know them by their fruits. Go ahead and read.
A good tree cannot bring forth evil fruit.
Uh-huh.
Neither can a corrupt tree bring forth good fruit.
Uh-huh.
Every tree that bringeth not forth good fruit is hewn down and cast into the fire.
Y'all know what that end is, right?
Yeah.
It's like a fire. Right? Go ahead.
Wherefore by their fruits ye shall know them.
Uh-huh.
Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, should enter into the kingdom of heaven.
Wait a minute. I thought what we had to do was call on his name. He said, not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven. Go ahead.
But he that doeth the will of my Father, which is in heaven.
That's the ultimate calling right there. You do the will of the Father, guess what? In that certain day, you can call upon his name and he's going to save you. Right? Go ahead.
Many will say to me in that day.
He said, I already know they're going to save me in that day. Go ahead.
Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name?
Jesus, Jesus, all up and down. Right? Go ahead.
And in thy name have cast out devils.
Uh-huh.
And in thy name done many wonderful works.
Uh-huh.
And then will I profess unto them, I never knew you. Depart from me, ye that work iniquity.
What is iniquity? So I'm arguing with this Christian like, what is iniquity? It's things that are, God doesn't like it. Bro, what is iniquity? You're trying to fight keeping that law. That's what you're trying to do. Bro, it's okay, bro. It's okay. Well, you know, if you keep good works and you help the homeless and you do... Bro, nah. He's talking about the law right there. Let's go to Acts 20. Let's talk about more about this law. Because everything is supposed to be nailed to the cross. And we dealt with yesterday what was actually nailed to the cross, which was sacrifice and oblation and the carnal ordinances that were against us.
Oh, yeah.
But everybody want that out. I said, if it was that easy, I'd have stayed in the Catholic Church. Yeah. Acts 20, and pick it up at verse 25. Read.
And now, behold, I know that ye all, among whom I have gone preaching the kingdom of God, shall see my face no more.
Uh-huh.
Wherefore I take you to record this day that I am pure from the blood of all men.
Uh-huh.
For I have not shunned to declare unto you all the counsel of God.
Uh-huh.
Take heed therefore unto yourselves and to all the flock over the which the Holy Ghost hath made you overseers to feed the church of God,
uh-huh,
which he had purchased with his own blood.
Ain't that something? So he said, y'all supposed to feed the church of God. Go ahead.
For I know this, that after my departing shall grievous wolves enter in among you,
uh-huh,
not sparing the flock.
Ain't that something? So we got some grievous wolves that's going to enter in among us, which is those false prophets. Go ahead and read.
Also of your own selves shall men arise,
uh-huh,
speaking perverse things to draw away disciples after them.
Ain't that something? So these false prophets want to get some disciples after them, and they're doing Satan's work. Let's go to Colossians, the second chapter. I don't think I got to skip any now. Colossians 2. And verse 8. So this is what Paul was warning them about in the book of Acts when he was getting ready to sail to Ephesus, which we're going to go back to Acts 20 and see why he had to do that sailing. But he was telling them about these grievous wolves. And he's going to tell you exactly why and how to avoid that. Colossians 2 and 8. Read that.
Beware lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit. After the tradition of men, after the rudiments of the world, and not after Christ.
So beware. Beware of that, because that's what's going to happen in the latter days, like he said. Let's go to Acts, the 20th chapter. Acts 20. And let's pick it up at verse 6. Now, in the book of Acts, is Christ dead or not? Christ is dead, buried, and rose, okay? He's already nailed on the cross,
yep.
The whole nine. Mm-hmm. So let's see what Paul was doing after Christ died. Acts 20 and 6, read that.
And we sailed away from Philippi after the days of unleavened bread and came unto them to Troas in 5 days, where we abode 7 days.
Is there a particular reason why he's dwelling there for 7 days? I think it would be unleavened bread. Well, let's go to verse 16 and just make sure. Verse 16, read that. Okay.
For Paul had determined to sail by Ephesus,
mm-hmm.
because he would not spend the time in Asia, for he hasted, if it were possible for him, to be at Jerusalem the day of Pentecost.
Ain't that something? So he like, right after unleavened bread, that count is starting. So he tried to make that sail to get to Jerusalem to make sure that he's there for the day of Pentecost. So you see, Paul was still keeping the feast, and now you got people saying, oh, yeah, you know, you've not in the land, you can't keep the feast of the Lord, and all that good stuff. No, we don't kill the lamb anymore for Passover and those things like that, but we still do keep the ordinance of the Passover as well as unleavened bread, and these things are what we see in the text. Let's see why we do it. Let's go to Deuteronomy 16. My boy Captain Tazariak from ISUPK, he said, Jarrell, I don't know why they don't want to keep the feast, man. I don't know. I guess it's because they can't cook or something. I don't know. I said, I'm using that, bro. Deuteronomy 16 and verse 16. Read.
3 times in a year shall all thy males appear before the Lord thy God in the place which he should choose.
Uh-huh.
In the feast of unleavened bread.
Uh-huh.
And in the feast of weeks.
Uh-huh.
And in the feast of tabernacles.
Uh-huh.
And they shall not appear before the Lord empty.
So this is what we're supposed to actually all come, especially the males, because they were the heads of the household in this time. He said, 3 times in a year shall all thy males appear before the Lord thy God in the place which he shall choose, which is the feast of unleavened bread, the feast of weeks, which is Pentecost, which is the 7 times 7, tomorrow after the Sabbath, which is that 49th day, that 50th day, which is Pentecost. That's the feast of weeks,
yep.
And the feast of tabernacles, which is the 7-day rejoicing feast. That's when we all supposed to appear before the Lord. And how are we supposed to appear? Not empty-handed.
Not empty-handed, no.
Can't be empty-handed, right? So, but and if anything, we're going to show you how you don't come empty-handed. Let's go to Deuteronomy 14. Because if you can't cook, I wouldn't recommend it. If you're unclean, I wouldn't recommend you cooking.
Gotcha.
So there's different ways that you can do these things, and especially if you're in a long journey as well.
Oh, yeah.
Because we got some people that came from out of town, and they had a 16 to 20-hour drive, and they're just now getting here to keep that feast.
Yep.
So guess what? We ain't going to turn them around. Come on, keep the feast with us. But it's a certain way we do these things as well.
Yes.
Deuteronomy 14 and verse 23. Read that, bro.
And thou shalt eat before the Lord thy God in a place which he shall choose to place his name there.
Uh-huh.
The tithe of thy corn, of thy wine,
uh-huh.
of thine oil, of the firstlings of thy herds, and of thy flocks.
Uh-huh.
That thou mayest learn to fear the Lord thy God always.
Okay, so in a Christian idea of tradition, I think that's a typo. I think that wine should be juice or apple juice or soda or something like that, because it can't be wine. No. Let's keep reading. Go ahead.
And if the way be too long for thee.
So this is somebody that's in a journey. Go ahead.
So that thou art not able to carry it,
uh-huh.
or if the place be too far from thee,
uh-huh.
which the Lord thy God shall choose to set his name there,
uh-huh.
when the Lord thy God hath blessed thee, then shalt thou turn it into money,
uh-huh.
and bind up the money in thine hand,
uh-huh.
and shall go unto the place which the Lord thy God shall choose.
Uh-huh.
That and thou shalt bestow that money for whatsoever thy soul lusted after.
So I just want y'all to know, lust means want, right? I ain't telling y'all that y'all can lust after a prostitute and all those things like that. That's outside of the law. This is the book of the law. So if it don't have to be explained if it's known, okay? I ain't telling y'all that y'all, look, whatever your soul loves, that he going to specify it to. Well, for what? Go ahead and
for
read.
For oxen.
Uh-huh.
Or for sheep.
Uh-huh.
Or for wine.
Uh-huh.
Or for strong drink.
Oh, so there wasn't a typo. Or for wine or for strong drink, right? So if y'all, you know, going to get down, doing y'all thing at the feast, y'all going to see drinks downstairs. All y'all new people that just came from the Sunday church, you're going to get this experience, okay? So y'all going to see how we actually feast. We're supposed to rejoice before the Lord, right?
Yeah, sure.
So we're rejoicing. Israel got to get their, you know, get their mind right. So they're going to be drinking as well. I recommend for those that haven't been here a little while, go at your own pace. Don't hang around the crews. You'll see the crews, right? You'll see them. They'll be like eight deep, right? Drinking amongst themselves. They'll have cups and limes and everything. Y'all know who I'm talking about. They've done this before. Relax, all right? Especially if you got an empty stomach, if you ain't getting nothing to eat in the line, and you just come down and drink. I know some people be at the feast, they don't even eat nothing. They just be drinking. So relax. If you ain't a veteran, relax. We got, you know, little areas where you can lay down. We ain't going to let y'all drive drunk or nothing like that, okay? Read that of that verse.
And thou shalt, or for whatsoever thy soul desired, and thou shalt eat there before the Lord thy God.
Uh-huh.
And thou shalt rejoice, thou and thine household.
So the whole household is supposed to be here. He said he's supposed to rejoice before the Lord. So that is exactly what we're going to do for the Feast of Unleavened Bread. Now, with the Feast of Unleavened Bread, we do have the food downstairs. So we're going to bless the food right after we finish up. But that's today's lesson, the Feast of Unleavened Bread, day one. Hope y'all got some understanding. We thank you for your time. Now, I know we're going to take a short break in between time. Brothers, we will need servers. So anybody that's able-bodied to get down there and serve, will we have a nice little, what do you call them, that BD got in his hand? Aprons. Yeah, we got the aprons. We'll get you guys aproned up and gloved up and everything. We'll serve the food. We'll call by tables, the whole nine. So you can read the regular announcements, and then if Mona have anything, I'm sure he'll come up. Yeah, just read them from the 23rd.
We like to welcome all our brothers and sisters to the Church of Israel, and we hope you'll come worship with us again. Our weekly Bible class starts at 11 a.m. Central Time every Sabbath. Bible question and answer starts at 2 p.m. every Sabbath. Internet members will be able to ask questions via live YouTube streaming. Anyone interested in being baptized, please contact Brother Marlon by phone or email. Church of Israel has a Bryan, Texas Bible study class located at 1909 South College, Bryan, Texas. The Church of Israel has a Jamaican Bible study class located in Portmore, Jamaica. Please contact the church for additional information. The Church of Israel Chicago cable TV program airing on Comcast Channel 36 every Friday evening at 8 p.m. and Monday mornings at 10 a.m. The Church of Israel has a Sacramento, California broadcast which airs on Sundays at 9 a.m. PST on Access, Sacramento Channel 18. The Feast of Unleavened Bread begins March 26th at sundown. Service will be held at the church on March 27th and 12 noon. Any hot dishes needed to be here by 11 a.m. We ask that all regular members please remember to bring your own Bible and scarves every Sabbath. The Bibles and scarves we have are for visitors and new members. Please return any Bible or scarf to the shelf prior to leaving. If you are parked in the center of the parking lot or blocking anyone in, please move your car immediately after class to let others out. Parents, no children should be in the sanctuary or parking lot without their parents. The Church of Israel has a dress code. Brothers, please remove any head covering upon entering the building. Do not wear sheevely shirts, shorts, sagging, tight fittings, fleece or jogging pants, or any other revealing pants. Sisters, please have a head covering. This is required. Hat, scarf, etc. For all girls and women, do not wear pants, shorts, mini dresses, halter tops of any kind, revealing splits, tight fitting or cleavage revealing attire, models apparel on. These are today's announcements.
Cool. So yeah, I don't have anything to add. You know how we usually do it, just for everybody that hasn't been here. We're going to have everybody that's not serving hang out up here for maybe about 10 to 15 minutes, and then we'll make a call for everybody to go downstairs in an orderly fashion. There's no particular way that we call the table, so don't think that y'all know what we're going to call first. Just head downstairs, sit at the table. We'll get you guys all, everybody get their food. Second thing, nobody's getting seconds before everybody gets there first, okay? Gotcha. Nobody's getting seconds until everybody gets there first. No take-home plates are going to be out at that time. But, yeah, we're going to stand and face Jerusalem. We're going to bless the food, and then we'll pray out. Lord God, thank you so much for letting the family come together again. We pray that the food is clean and good for long life. In Jesus' name, we pray for this first day of unleavened bread. We pray that nothing is leavened bread downstairs so that it will not have to be thrown away, because we will find it. In Jesus' name, we pray. Amen.
Amen. Our Father, which art in heaven.
Our Father, which art in heaven.
Hallowed be thy name.
Hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come.
Thy kingdom come.
Thy will be done in earth.
Thy will be done in earth.
As it is in heaven.
As it is in heaven.
Give us this day.
Give us this day.
Our daily bread.
Our daily bread.
And forgive us our debts.
And forgive us our debts.
As we forgive our debtors.
As we forgive our debtors.
And lead us not into temptation.
And lead us not into temptation.
But deliver us from evil.
But deliver us from evil.
For thine is the kingdom.
Thine is the kingdom.
And the power.
And the power.
And the glory.
And the glory.
Forever.
Forever.
In Jesus' name we pray.
In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord God of Israel.
Praise the Lord God of Israel.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.